here. We have some new faces here who I am very excited about. And let's get to it. Stephen Foster, he lives in Pennsylvania, well north of the Mason-Dixon line, and he's in his teens and 20s writing these songs that are homages to the mythic Deep South. He has no idea what it's like except from literature, so-called literature, and not only are his songs really evocative of this scene, of this world, but they are great songs. In fact, from the beginning of America through the beginning of the 20th century, there was nobody who came close to Stephen Foster. He was such a heavy guy. His songs are so great. They are, can you get the feeling that I like the guy? My Old Kentucky Home, Camptown Races, you know. Old Black Joe. They were of the time, they weren't enlightened. But they were truthful as far as he knew it. In fact, he wrote the old Folks at Home, which is the other name, the correct name for Swanee River, to enlighten people, to give a softer feeling, a more accurate supposedly feeling of the Deep South, rather than the minstrel show media that they were getting. So he writes these songs, and he's a terrific craftsman. This is a song that you know. The lyric is about a guy who's leaving his girlfriend, and he's trying to jolly her up. He's leaving her for a while, and he's trying to make it a little easier on her by joking around, but he's breaking her heart. The lyric is very straightforward. Come on, honey, laugh it up. And the music is just beautiful. I'm just gonna sing one of the verses. It's so heavy.
Well, it rained all night the day I left. Weather, it was dry. Sun so hot, I froze to death. Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, Susanna, why don't you cry for me? For I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee.
That song is, it's like it was written by some anonymous person 300 years ago. It's so iconic, it's so strong, the pillars of the song are so strong. So let's jump ahead 70 years. There's a big gap in songwriting talent during that time. It kind of ended with Irving Berlin, and it ended with young Jacob Gershwitz, George Gershwin, who you may or may not know was, had no interest in music until he was 10, when the family bought a piano for the older brother, Ira, who wrote a lot of Gershwin's lyrics. And Ira was 12, but had no interest in the piano. Young George picked it up, snapped it right up, in fact, studied seriously. And by age 15, he was such a great piano player that he was going around pitching tunes. At the time, you made your money on tunes, mostly by selling sheet music. So he would go in buildings like the Brill Building in New York from door to door and say, hey, listen to this. You know, sing the tune, perform the tune. He was such a dazzling player that he would cut piano rolls, piano versions of the song that still exist. So there are records now of just the player pianos, and some of them are really good now. Steinway makes a player piano adaption of Gershwin playing whatever, the popular music of the time, and even Rhapsody in Blue. So Gershwin is becoming known, you know, he's bubbling under the surface, as Billboard says, and he gets together with Irving Caesar. Does anybody know who Irving Caesar? Irving Caesar, one of his big tunes was T for Two, which we're going to get to in a little while. Irving Caesar is the, my favorite Irving Caesar line is, he was being interviewed and somebody said to him, which comes first, the words or the music? And he says, what comes first is the phone call. And it's true. So in this case, the phone call was from a theatrical agent who needed a song for a play, and the song was about the South, lo and behold. And Gershwin investigated Suwannee River. He knew a good song when he heard it. So the two most prominent, it's like the strongest chunks of DNA in Suwannee River are the little melody up front. There's three notes. And then this thing that happens towards the, at the emotional climax of the tune, that it's a little counter melody. There's a lot of tension in that. So Gershwin took it and wrote Suwannee. In the first few notes has both of those elements, those three notes and that little counter melody. And it was a huge hit, some say the biggest hit of his career, and it was Gershwin, I think, announcing to the world that Gershwin is the next Stephen Foster, and you better watch out. So let's do this tune, and we're going to do it not in the traditional way. Let's do it, we're going to try an experiment. We're going to fuse the DNA from 1970s Miles Davis music, in a silent way. So the field is like. Dan and Casey, you can't overplay on this. You can't play too much no matter what you play. I promise you. We'll be right back. And they really jumped to it, and I haven't met them actually until tonight. So this is Ben Loffer on drums. A man whose name, last time I'm not even sure of. What is your last name?
Casares.
Yeah. Dan Casares. Dan and I go way back about 15 minutes. That's the thing about jazz and a lot of other pop-related styles, that you know enough, you're familiar enough with the idiom so that you can step in and hopefully do a good job. So where were we? Oh yeah, I want to depart from Gershwin for a second and talk about Irving Caesar. We're going to do a tune of his that, well, T for Two. And the reason I bring it up is that we're going to talk for a minute about chord cadences, chord progressions. And there's this kind of chord progression that we call a 2-5 progression. You don't have to know why, but it's a series of cascading, it's like a waterfall of harmonies. Like, chord inevitably leads to the next, and it's not new. It goes back to the 17th century. You associate it with with classical music, and Brahms did it, and it fits into so much music. It's just this little this waterfall of sound. So Gershwin was very good at it, but there's one tune that's overuses this so wonderfully. That's T for Two. And the story of T for Two is that Irving Caesar and Vincent Newmans were given this assignment to write, I think, to this melody, and they're playing around with the melody. And lots of times, songwriters will write dummy lyrics, just blah, 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 like the Paul McCartney's first lyric for Yesterday was, "Scrambled eggs, how I love to eat my scrambled eggs," and they plug in the real lyric. And Irving Caesar was experimenting with blah, 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 blah. And you and me and T for Two, and his partner said, "That's it, tea for two. And Irving Caesar said, no way. He said, it's too dumb. So history is our friend in that. Let me change the piano sound a little bit. We're going to take this and infuse this song with sort of a Brazilian feel. That's okay, Casey.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I forgot my shaker, sorry.
Oh,
you're going to
be playing lead on this.
Oh! Okay, are we playing the hit on this?
Would you please?
Yeah.
You got it.
How about we trade off?
All right.
You take the last bar.
Thank you.